Good day. You're welcome to SS2 online chemistry class. I'm Okiti Okemoko Muhammad, and this afternoon I'll be taking you on chemistry, at least for the few minutes. I've already given the scheme that we have, it's already uploaded to you, it's in your notes, I mean, so you take it. And one of the things we're treating is redox reaction. Of course, we've done certain things in second term on redox reaction. We treated how you know the one that's oxidation and reduction. Where we'll start from now, this term is oxidation number. Now, when we say oxidation number, most of the times we also take it at times to be distinct with what oxidation states. Well, at a level, let's take it so, but there's differences, okay? Now, when you talk about oxidation number, phosphorus, nitrogen, carbon, etc. Those ones can have more than one type of position number in any, depending on the chemical reaction or the compound that it finds itself. So such will be we have different type of position number. So they have the ability of possessing different type of position number, meaning that such compounds possess what we call what? Variable oxidation state. They have variable oxidation state. They have various valences. Therefore, the oxidation number will also be what? Different. That's oxidation number. Now, for trinary compounds, or trinary compound, a trinary compound is a type of compound that consists of maybe two or more elements. A very good example is CO3. This is a trinary compound because it contains hydrogen, carbon, and oxygen. Now, the first element here will always be positive. Then the second element, we always have oxidation number that is also what? Positive. This one will be positive oxidation number. This one will be negative oxidation number. But the middle element, whether it is a metal or non-metal, will have what? A positive what? Oxidation number. Whether it is a metal or non-metal, it will form a positive what? Oxidation number. And please take note that this always have what? It's always in association with the oxygen. So it's an ozone anion. You can say it now. So anion. So the oxidation state here will always be what? Positive. Whether it is metal, non-metal, or what? Metalloid. The oxidation state will always be what? Positive in trinary compounds. So oxidation state is very important. Okay, the next thing we are going to look into now is the uses of oxidation state. Well, as I've said before, I said it's very important. Where does it find its use? When it comes to naming of compound, oxidation states form the basis of naming of compound, inorganic compounds, when it comes to what? IUPAC what? Nomenclature. So it's very important. You hear sodium tetrasulfate, cis. That cis is for sulfur, which is the middle element in the trinary compound. So it's going to have what? It's going to have oxidation state of what? Plus cis. That's what it means. So you must mention it. You must what? Mention what? It. The oxidation state of the middle element. If it's a binary compound, like CO2 now, is the first element you are going to measure the what? Oxidation number, oxidation state of it. For instance, this is carbon what? Carbon 4 what? Oxide. So this carbon 4 oxide, the oxidation state here is for the first element, which is 4. And the rule for naming of the a binary compound is that you measure the first element first, then the oxidation state of the first element first, before you now mention the what? The last element. If it is oxygen, it ends with what? Oxide. The prefix, suffix IDE will be added to it. Hide. Oxide. If it is chlorine, chloride. If it's bromine, bromide, and so on. So that is the root for things. So you can see that oxidation state is important here in naming inorganic words, compound, using IUPAC nomenclature. Then another uses of oxidation number is to determine whether certain reactions can be classified as oxidation or reduction reaction. As oxidation or reduction what? Reaction. In other words, it will tell us whether electrons are transferred, how electrons were transferred, and how electrons were what? Gained. So what if electrons are transferred, you know, transfer of electron, in other words, loss of electron is oxidation. Definitely oxidation number will increase if there's loss of what? Electrons. The gain of electron will lead to what? Reduction in oxidation what? Number. So the number of electrons that is lost will determine the oxidation number of what? The compound. So loss of electron is what? Oxidation. Gain of electron is what? Reduction. And we have done that in the past. Now let us look at how do we name how do we calculate oxidation states? How do we calculate oxidation states? There are certain rules for calculating oxidation states. There are certain rules for calculating oxidation states. Now, what are the rules? Number one, you should know that the sum of all elements, the sum of the oxidation state of all elements in a compound must be what? Equal to what? Zero. What I'm saying is that, for instance, you have H2SO4 now. The sum of the oxidation state of every element present here must be equal to zero. For instance, hydrogen is plus one, and we have two atoms of hydrogen. Sulfur is plus six. Oxygen is what? Minus two, and we have four atoms of oxygen. Everything must give you what? Zero. So if you have this together, you see that you are going to get what? Zero. So the sum of oxidation state of every element, of all elements in a compound, will be equal to what? Zero. Okay? Then the next thing is another rule, is rule two. The sum of oxidation states of all elements in ions, let's say like ozone ions, all those complex ions, the sum of the oxidation states must be equal to what? The net charge of what? The ion itself. For instance, SO42 minus is an ion or a radical. Now this radical, if you add all the oxidation states together, you can see that the charge, the overall charge of this, of the ion, is minus two. Now the sum of all the oxidation states of this, if you sum them together, it's going to be equal to what? The overall charge of what? The ion. What am I saying? Whereas sulfur is plus six, Oxygen is minus 2. We have 2 atoms here. Minus 2 times 4 will give you 8. Everything will be equal to what? Minus 2. This minus 2 is the net charge. Then 6 minus 8 will be equal to minus 2. Then when you remove 6 from 8, you have minus 2 equal to what? Minus 2. So you see that the sum of all the charges in the sum of all the elements in a radical or a complex ion is equal to what? The net or the overall charge of what? The ion. That is rule 2. Then another rule is that any element in an occupying state, element in its free state that has not undergo chemical reaction, your zero state is what? Zero. So for instance, sodium atom, now the zero state is zero. Gas and neutron molecules, their zero states are what? Zero. This one now is zero. Oxygen gas is zero. Even ozone, the zero state is zero. What do you call it now? Any element you can think of, the zero state is what? Zero. In aspect, as no one that go chemical reaction, the zero state is what? Zero. In other words, it's in its free state, an uncombined what? State. Then the next thing is the oxidation state. How do I put it now? For hydrogen, the zero state of hydrogen is plus 1. Hydrogen. Generally, the zero state is always plus 1. But there are some cases like hydrogen gas and the zero state is 0. And there are some compounds like hydrides. The zero state of hydrogen there will be what? Negative. Then another rule again is that for oxygen, the oxygen state of oxygen is what? Minus 2. But there are some cases. Like in a gas, just like what I said, gas, the general state of oxygen gas, O2, is zero. Then, in perovskites, the general state is what? Of oxygen is what? Minus 1. So that's what you need to understand as the rules for calculating what oxidation number. Now, how do you calculate the oxidation number? I think what I've been doing is I've been bringing out some of these things. It depends on whether it's an ion or what? A compound. A very good example is when you are told to calculate the oxidation state of potassium tetraozomanganate 7. Potassium tetraozomanganate 7 is KMnO4. It's a compound. So if you want to look for the zero states, as a compound, you go to one of the rules I told you, that the sum of the zero state of all elements in a compound is equal to what? Zero. And since it's manganese, they ask you to look for the zero state. Have it in mind that it's manganese, they ask you to look for the zero state. So meaning you have the zero state of potassium now, for instance, is plus 1, and you only have one atom of potassium. You must account for number of atoms. Plus, let's say the zero state of manganese is X, because that's what we are looking for. You write X. I wish manganese is 2 here. Two manganese atoms. You put what? 2S here. 2S here. If it is 3 manganese atoms, you put 3 here. You must indicate the number of atoms. Then, let's come to oxygen. Just the state of oxygen is minus 2. And we have 4 oxygen atoms. So, times what? 4. Everything must be equal to what? 0. That's the rule. So, you see that plus 1 plus S minus 8 is equal to what? 0. So S will not be equal to what? It just across the side become what? 8 minus 1. So the zero state is what? Plus 7. So you can see that the zero state of manganese is plus 7. And I told you before that for trinary compound, the middle element must have what? A positive oxidation state. So that's the oxidation state of what? Manganese in this compound. That's what you call it what? Potassium tetraozomanganate what? 7. That's how you do it. Then let's look at another compound. For instance, if you are told or asked to look for the opposite of, let's say, a compound like this, it's still a compound. So, some of the opposite of the compound element in it will be equal to what? Zero. So, now, for binary compounds, it is, well, in a minute, it is the first element you measure the zero state. So if you have to look for the zero state of ion in this compound now, it's going to be what? It's going to be, we have two ions here, two atoms of ion, two times, let's call ion, let's assume that ion is S. Now let ion be S. Two times S plus what? Oxygen of oxygen is minus two. We have three oxygen atoms here, times three, equal to what? Zero. So if you do the calculation, you are going to have 2x minus 6 equal to what? Zero. Of course, when 2s, this cross on this side, you have what? Plus 6. Divide both sides by 2, you have what? Plus 3. So the other set of ion here is what? Plus 3. That's why it's called what? Ion 3 oxide. It's called what? Ion 3 what? Oxide. Okay. Let's look at that of anions. Ions. For instance, if you have maybe let's say this copper now PO43- to look for the zero state of phosphorus here. Just as we have said, you follow the rule that said that the sum of the zero state of all elements in an ion or a radical must be equal to what? The net charge of the radical. So in this case, you have what? The aqueous compounds on the sides of the equation into their component words ions. All the aqueous compounds, the aqueous, you be able to what? That's what you will split. Another thing again you should have in mind is that if
we have any molecule that is either a solid, like metals, or even not metal, it's a solid, it's in solid state. Then you have some maybe in liquid state, you have in gaseous state. Such compounds, you don't need to split them, they will remain. It's only those that are in aqueous form that you are going to what? Splits into their component ions. Then after you have split them into their component ions, you cancel ions that are common to both sides of the equation, left hand side, right hand side. Check which ones are common. The ones that are common are the ones that you are going to cancel. So you have canceled them. Whatever that is remaining is what you want. You bring out as your what? Ionic what? Equation. A very good example is if you are asked to convert this now. You are asked to convert this to ionic form. In ionic form, this is one major and good example. You can see that this is in aqueous state, this one is in aqueous state, this one is in gaseous state. So you do not touch this. You only split one of aqueous. If I'm to split this now, I'm going to have what? 2Fe2+. Notice ion 2 chloride. So the opposite of ion here is plus 2. We have talked about ion, no, it's just the first element. So this is aqueous. Chlorine is what? You split it now, you have what? 2 times 2, that would be 4. We have 2 chlorine minus, 4 chlorine minus. This one will remain Cl2 because it's a gas, that's why it's going to remain. I've told you, solid, liquid, gas must remain. Then this one, this ion 3 chloride. So the opposite of ion here is plus 3. So you have what? 2Fe3+ aqueous plus. Then chlorine here, 2 times 3 will give you 6. So you have CCl what? Minus, also in aqueous form. So what do you do? I told you, the ones that are common are the ones you cancel out. Cancel this and this. So you see that here was 4, here is 6. So 2 is remaining here. 2Cl minus chloride ion is remaining here. So you bring out the net equation, which will become what? This. Then this. Then what is remaining here will be what? 2Fe3+8+. So this is how you what? You write equation in its ionic form. It's very important you know how to do this. Then another good example that we are going to look into is potassium iodide, aqueous, and Fe2SO43 aqueous. Then we have iodine solid. We have iodine solid, then P2SO4 aqueous, and 2FeSO4 aqueous. Now this is the compound, and you are asked to provide it, put it in ionic form. As I said before, this aqueous, all the aqueous ones will be splitted. So this will become what now? 2K+ aqueous plus 2I- aqueous. I splitted this. I come to this now. This is 3. So this is this ion 3 chloride, 3 of the C's. So it's going to be 2Fe3+ aqueous plus 3SO42 minus aqueous. Then this one is a solid, so it will remain. Then if you split this, this will be K, this will be 2K plus, then that's aqueous. Then this one will be what? K, sorry. That's SO42 minus aqueous. Then this one will be what? 2Fe2 plus aqueous plus what? 2SO42 minus aqueous. You can see. Now you cancel out what is common to both sides. This and this are common. So it has cancelled out. Then let's look at it again. What is common here? So we have 3SO42 minus here. This one SO42 minus. This another SO2SO42 minus. So it has this one has cancelled that. So I want to bring out the net equation now. So here it's going to be what? 2I minus aqueous plus 2Fe3 plus aqueous to give what? I2X plus 2Fe2 plus aqueous. So you can see that we are through with that. If you check the charges now, yes, minus 1 plus 3. You get minus 2, you get plus 3, plus 2, sorry. This one is 0, this one is plus 2. So plus 2, plus 2, the equation is balanced. Even the one we did before, it's still the same thing you do in that case. So that's how you split what? Ions into what? Compounds into what? Their ionic form. Now, the last thing we are going to look into now, before we call it a day, is splitting redox equation into half what equation.
You see that? Okay, splitting redox equation into half equation. Splitting redox equation into half what? Now, for every redox equation, two pair of reactions are taking place, half reactions are taking place in that reaction. One is oxidation, the other one is what? Reduction. They are taking place towards simultaneously. So, when you are given an equation, how do you know the one that is? How do you split them into the various halves? Half what equation? That is what we are going to look into now. Now, what are the rules that you use? Number one, if the equation is in normal form, you first of all convert it to what? The ionic form. Then, after converting to ionic form, make sure that the equation is what? Balanced. Then when the equation is balanced, the next thing you do is to assign oxidation number to the various species on both sides of the equation and note the change in the oxidation number of each species at both sides. Then when you are through with that, you now write out the half equation for the species that has a decrease in the oxidation number. When you are able to write it out, the one that have decrease in oxidation number, it shows that it is that one that will what? Reduction. Anyone that has decrease in oxidation number, after you have put the oxidation number, you find that there's decrease from left to right. That is, you are noticing that in the product side, there's decrease in oxidation number. That means that that species or moiety is undergo reduction. So you write it out. You also write for that of the word oxidation. So if you see that the oxidation number increases, then it means that what it is what? Oxidation. What it means is that here we have a less oxidation number, left hand side. Then the right hand side we have what? A higher oxidation number. That to tell you that what? That reaction is what?
oxidation. As immediately you write the oxidation number, you see that it increases. Then nobody, you don't need to be told that, well, it is what?
Oxidation.
Then when you are through in doing that, splitting it, what do you now do? You balance the flow of what? Electrons. The electrons for oxidation must be equal to the number of electrons for what? Reduction. In other words, the number of electrons given out must be equal to the number of electrons that is what? That is gained.
Then after that, the last thing I need to what? To check the charges on both sides. Please, that for simple ions. For simple ions, you check the charges on both sides. But for complex ions, because we have oxy anions, you don't need to check what? Charges. Then measure the number of electrons what? Are the same. So that's what you do. So now let us solve a problem and see. Let's do one or two problems so that you see what I'm talking about. For instance, if you are told to split the oxidation state of
a particular compound, let's say the one we did today, Cl2 aqueous plus Cl2 gas, to split it into the various form Fe. That's 2FeCl3 aqueous. If you are told to split this, of course, what we saw today was that we have what? 2Fe2 plus aqueous plus Cl2 gas giving you 2Fe3 plus. I think that was a 2Cl, right? Minus.
The first one we did today, you know, the aqueous solution. I think that's what we got. Okay, let's use that. Let's apply this in splitting. Let's split this as an example. Now, what do you do here? If you look at this, first of all, check if it's balanced. Two ion here, so it's balanced. Two chlorine here. So it's very balanced. The number of atoms present are what? Balanced. Then the next thing I will now assign oxidation state. Oxidation state of ion here is plus 2. The oxidation state of here is 0. Remember, it's a molecule. Here is what? Oxidation number is plus 3. Here the oxidation number is what? Minus 1. Now, if you look at the equation, let's look at that of ion. Ion changes from what? Plus 2 to plus 3. Increase in oxidation number. Meaning it lost what? Electron. Increase in oxidation number. So since it increased oxidation number, which is loss of electrons, is it not oxidation? Yes, oxidation. So you now break that out. So you have what? 2Fe2 plus giving you what? 2Fe3 plus. So this one is the what? Oxidation. Why this other one is what? Reduction. That will be Cl2 gas to give you what? 2Cl- So that is that. This is one is what? Reduction. I've stated it. But this thing is not complete if you don't account for the number of what? Electrons. If you don't account for the number of electrons. So how do we account for
numbers of electrons? How do we account for numbers of what? Electrons. Now, let me quickly take you to what we call oxidation scale. There's a table called oxidation number scale. Oxidation number scale range from minus 4 to 7. You can see it ranges from here to this. Take note. When the oxidation number increases like this, it's a sign of what? Oxidation. But when it comes like this, it is what? Reduction. It is reduction.
Now, let's watch. For ion 2 chloride, for ion 2 plus, as you know, I change from plus 2 to plus 3. Plus 2 to plus 3. It means that electron, look at it. This scale will tell you two things. So you know the number of electrons that was transferred. From plus 2 to plus 3, now one electron was transferred. One electron was utilized here. From here to here, you got one electron. Here to here, one electron. So one electron was utilized here. So meaning, one electron was involved from plus 2 to plus what? 3. Then you watch, it was increasing to the right. It tells you that, another thing it tells you that is that, you are going to put the electron in what? At the right hand side. So if I want to, let me continue with this. We have seen that it is oxidation because it increases from left to right. And it's told you that it's going to west right. So meaning there's giving out of what? Electron. So meaning I'm going to add electron here. Now it's supposed to be one electron. It's supposed to be what? One what? Electron. But look at this. Two atoms of ions are involved here. Two atoms of ion. So one atom of ion gave out one electron. So, okay. Then another atom of ion gave out another electron. That's why you have two atoms here. So together, how many electrons were given out? That's what? Two electrons. So you are going to put what? Two electrons. You know why? You understand why I put two here now? Because two atoms were involved. One atom gave out one electron, as we have seen. But we have two atoms all together here. So two electrons all together were donated. You understand? So the number of electrons that's given out is the number of electrons that will be received. Now, for this same compound now, for this other reduction is acceptance of electron. It means that it accepted electron. You can see that the arrow moved to where it was, the left. That means that we are going to put the number of electrons at where? The left-hand side. So if I want to put it here, since it was two electrons that were given out, it's two electrons that will be received. So I'm going to what? Put the electron here. 2e what? Minus. 2e minus. So you can see that what? I place the electron at the left-hand side. So this one accepted reduction. Why this one what? Donated oxidation. That's how you what? You handle such problem. You must account for the number of what? Electrons. So that's how you do such problem. Okay? Then let's look at another one. This one is for anions. It's a bit different from the one we just did now. I think that's where we stop. For the complex anions, splitting an equation into its complex, that is a complex equation into its halves, is a bit different from that of the simple equation that we just did now. It's a bit what? Different. It's a bit different. Okay? Now, I will give you some example, then we'll use it to solve problem. Let's say we have Cr2O72 minus aqueous reacting with what? C2O42 minus aqueous to give you Cr3 plus aqueous plus CO2 gas. You can see this compound. It contains oxyanion. So it's complex. So the procedure is a bit different from that of the one we did before. Now, a very good example of how you handle problems like this is for you to first of all balance the equation. You must balance the equation. Now, how do you balance the equation? Make sure the number of atoms on the left hand side is equal to the number of atoms that are on the right hand side. So here now, this C2, carbon is 2 here, but it's not balanced here. So I'll put 2 here.
Then chromium is 2 here. Yeah,